Romans chapter number 1. All right, let's stand together, please. We'll just read a few verses to get us started, and then we'll get right into the lesson this evening. Romans chapter number 1 and verse number 1. The Bible says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request, if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Now I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I purposed to come unto you, but was led hitherto, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. Well, tonight we're going to begin looking at Romans chapter number 1. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you tonight that we have this opportunity to be here. And Lord, I would ask you that this evening, Lord, you would give me the words that need to be spoken. Lord, that I might be a help and a blessing to these that have gathered together, Lord, on this Wednesday evening. Lord, I know many are here tonight. God, they are weary, Lord, from a long day. God, they've got many things on their minds. And Lord, I do know tonight that as we're gathered together that the devil would not want us to be able to concentrate on the Word of God. But Lord, he'd have our minds in so many other places. So Lord, I pray tonight for the next few moments that each of us, Lord, would seek your word and seek the truth that's found therein. God, that we wouldn't think about the cares of tomorrow, but Lord, we would deal with the issue at hand, Lord, your precious word. And God, I pray that as we look in your word tonight, God, that you would speak to our hearts. And God, that you would draw us closer to Jesus Christ. The greatest need, Lord, that each of us have tonight is a closer relationship with Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray tonight that through this service that you would accomplish that in our hearts and, Lord, in our minds. Lord, be with us now as we look at Romans chapter number 1. I pray the Word of God would be clear, be understandable. And Lord, I pray when we leave this place tonight, we will have a truth, God, that you've imparted to our hearts, Lord, that will help us as we serve you in these days. Now, Lord, be with us. Thank you for these folks that are here tonight. Pray you'd bless them for their faithfulness. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. You may be seated this evening. As we begin our study of the epistle of Paul, the apostle to the Romans, we must remember both the theme and the general outline of this epistle. Now, the theme is so clearly stated throughout the book that you cannot but understand clearly what the theme is. The theme is simply this: the gospel of God. And not only is the theme clearly stated in the first verse of Romans chapter number 1, it's also a continual theme throughout the other 16 chapters. So what we find here is that the book of Romans is about the gospel of God. There in Romans 1, in verse 1, it says, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. We have the gospel of Matthew, the gospel of Mark, the gospel of Luke, and the gospel of John. Now, within those four gospels, we see what the true gospel is. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's through the gospels that we learn the gospel story. The reason we know about the death of Christ is because it's contained in the gospels. The reason we know about his burial and his resurrection is because it's contained in the gospels. And so in the gospels, we have the record of the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Well, it is in the book of Romans that we have the application of the gospel. And so as we go through the book of Romans, we see how that the gospel has power, and it has power to save us, but it also has power to transform us into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the outline that we're going to use tonight for this study follows along this simple theme. So in chapters 1 through 3, we've got the purpose of the gospel of God. In chapters 4 through 11, we have the provision of the gospel of God. And finally, in chapters 12 through 16, Paul describes the power of the gospel of God. And we're going to look at those when we get to those chapters. And I think it'll be a help to you in your Christian life as we begin to break down the gospel. And it's the reason that we need it, and what it does after we receive it. And so that's what the book of Romans is all about. Now, as we begin our study of chapter 1, we need to remember that this chapter falls under point 1 of our study outline, which is the purpose of the gospel of God. And it's in chapter number 1 that Paul is going to deal with some preliminary thoughts. He's going to begin dealing with the very first reason for the gospel of God. And so chapter 1 is basically an introduction to the remainder of the book. So for our study of chapter 1, we're going to use this simple outline. Number 1, the preface of the epistle. In the first 6 verses, we have the preface of the remainder of the book. In verses 7 through 15, we have the people of the church. You're going to find that Paul loves these people, and we'll see that when we get to the verses of Scripture. And then we'll see the power of the gospel, verses 16 and 17, and then the plight of the world, verses 18 through 32. And so that's a general outline of Romans chapter 1, and that's kind of the outline that we're going to follow as we go verse by verse through Romans chapter number 1. Now, we're not going to get all through 32 verses tonight. That's going to be an impossibility for us, but we're going to get as far as we can with our time that is allotted. So let's go ahead and look at the first 6 verses, the preface of this epistle. Look with me there at verse number 1. Paul starts out, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Now, in biblical days, the way that they wrote a letter, they started with who was writing the letter so that you could know the author. And so here Paul clearly identifies himself as the author of the book of Romans. And we understand that the Holy Spirit of God is the true author of all Scripture, but Paul was that instrument, that tool, that person that God used to pin down this letter to these Roman believers. And so, the author, of course, is Paul. But notice the attitude of Paul in verse number 1. He says this, Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ. Paul could have called himself many things. He could have dealt with many different things that he has done. He could have given a long pedigree of who he is and what he has done. But we find that the first remarks that Paul makes about himself is simply this, a servant of Jesus Christ. And that's how Paul looked at himself. He did not look at himself as a great one. As a matter of fact, when you read through Paul's writings, he says that he has not attained yet. And you'll find over and over again, he'll mention his own shortcomings. And even when he writes to Timothy, he reminds Timothy that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. And so Paul looked at himself a little bit differently than you probably would look at the Apostle Paul. And what I'm saying is this, Paul had a humble spirit about himself, and he saw himself as simply a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is exactly how the Apostle Paul lived his life. He lived his life as a servant of Christ. Christ would lead him, and we find that Paul would follow the leadership of the Lord. One great example of that was that the Apostle Paul wanted to go east. He wanted to go farther into Asia, but he received that Macedonian call. And so instead of him going east, Paul went the exact opposite direction, and Paul went west. Now, Paul had a great desire to go east. He essayed to go. He tried to go, but the Spirit would not allow him to go. And so Paul went the exact opposite direction because he was a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe that the greatest success that Paul achieved in his ministry was not necessarily because Paul was a great man. I believe it was this, that Paul was simply a servant of the Lord Jesus, and he lived his life under the lordship of Christ. And that's a good place for all of God's children to live, under the authority and the lordship of Christ. And listen, He is Lord. He is in charge, and we're supposed to be His servants. Oftentimes in prayer, we go to God and tell God what we want from Him. But the truth of the matter is this, in prayer, we ought to go to God and simply report for duty and allow God to lead us in the way that He would have us to go. And so Paul was a servant of Jesus Christ. John Gill wrote this about this verse and Paul being a servant. He wrote this, "A servant of Jesus Christ, not a servant of sin, nor of Satan, nor of man, nor of Moses and his law, nor of the traditions of the elders, but of Jesus Christ." And listen, Paul rubbed a lot of people the wrong way because he didn't do everything that traditional way that the Jews required. He would rub people the wrong way left and right. But listen, he was a servant and a follower of Jesus Christ. And so Paul was a true servant of Jesus Christ. When God said go, and he went. And when God said no, he stopped. And the majority of his life was lived in subjection to the will of God. And so here we find that Paul is a servant of Jesus Christ. But next, notice this, that we see the author of the book of Romans there in verse 1, the attitude of Paul there in verse number 1, but also the apostleship of Paul. It says this, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God. Now, Peter was and is what was the apostle of the Jews. We find that Paul mentions that in Galatians and in Romans, but Paul was an apostle to the Gentiles. He was raised up for a specific purpose. The 12 original apostles, they were to go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That was where their apostleship led. But not so with Paul. Paul was to go to the Gentiles. He was an apostle of the Gentiles. And let me ask you this, who did Paul reach more than anyone else? He reached the Gentiles. Why? Because that's what God called him to do. And so Paul was an apostle of the Gentiles. And notice the Bible says there, he's called to be an apostle, but it also says he's separated unto the gospel of God. And so in that statement, we see Paul's sole purpose, and that is being separated unto the ministry that God had given him. Paul's whole life was about being separated unto the gospel of God. Yes, Paul was a tent maker, and he did earn extra money by making tents. We understand that. But Paul's main thrust was not about making money. His thrust of ministry in life was about reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's amazing to me. If you study the life of Paul and you pull down a map and you begin to follow Paul's travels, you'll find that Paul did more in his day than most missionaries do in our day. And he had less conveniences than we have in our day. Why? Because he was simply separated unto the gospel and he followed the leadership of God in his day-to-day life. And so Paul was a man who was separated unto the gospel. You know, we often hear what we're separated from, but you know, I think every once in a while we need to know what we're separated unto. Right? We need to be separated unto the gospel. And if we're separated unto Christ and His gospel, I found it takes care of a lot of the other things that we want to be separated from because we would not want the gospel to be hindered. And so Paul was an apostle, and he was separated unto the gospel of God, and that was his sole purpose. That was his calling in life, and God used the apostle Paul greatly in that. Now look at verse number 2. The Bible says, which He had promised afore by His prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Now, what is that which He promised? So we see a promise, but what was it that He promised? Well, this goes back up to the gospel of God in verse number 1. And so here there's a promise which He had promised afore. And so Paul is an apostle of the gospel of God, but this gospel is not some strange thing. It's something that God had even promised in the Old Testament Scriptures. He promised afore by His apostles. Now, whenever we started the series a couple of weeks ago and we looked at the introductory notes, you'll remember that I listed 60 references of the Old Testament that Paul used in his writing. 60 references in these 16 chapters referring to the Old Testament Scriptures that deal with this gospel. Now you imagine that, 60 of them. And so Paul clearly understood that this salvation, that this gospel was something that was not an accident. This gospel was not a plan B. Paul understood that this gospel was according to the promise and the plan of Almighty God. Listen, Jesus didn't die on accident. This was something that was planned even before the foundation of the world. And when you find Jesus mentioned, you'll find that the Bible talks about Him being as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. That means the plan was set in place. And so the Lord knew that men were going to be sinners. And even before the first man sinned, God already was going to provide a Savior in His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we find here that that there's a promise, and that's the promise of the gospel. Now notice the prophets here. It talks about promised afore by His prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Now, there are two types of prophets in the Bible. There are the speaking prophets, the oral prophets, and there's the writing prophets. The oral prophets, the non-writing prophets, were men like Enoch and Elijah and Elisha. They did not pen one verse of Scripture, but they were prophets of God, and they stood and spoke on behalf of the Lord. And listen, their ministries were great, and their ministries were impactful. Their ministries were exactly what God wanted for them, and that's the oral prophets. But the prophets that we're reading about here, he's talking about the writing prophets, such as men such as Daniel, Hosea, and Joel. He's talking about Moses, who wrote the first five books of the Old Testament. He's talking about the men that God moved upon, and they penned down the Holy Scriptures. You remember a few weeks ago we were in the Gospel of Luke. We were looking at the end of the Gospel of Luke, and there were two discouraged disciples on the road to Emmaus. And you remember what Jesus did? Jesus opened up the Scriptures, and He began in the Pentateuch, and He began to go through all the Scriptures and the Law and the Prophets, and He preached Himself and the gospel unto them from those things. And what I'm saying is this, this was a plan of God. This was not, when Adam sinned, God didn't say, oh no, I didn't plan for this. God didn't say, uh-oh, what am I going to do now? No, He had a plan in place even long before Adam had sinned. This plan was in place. And so the prophets recorded that for us. The writing prophets were the ones who preserved these words. Look at Romans 16. You're right there. I know I've got a lot of verses that we're not looking at, and you can go home and you can run these different references, but I do want to show you a few of the verses tonight. Romans 16, look down at verse number 26. Romans 16 and verse number 26. The Bible says, but now is manifest, and by the Scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of the faith. Those prophets, the Scriptures in the Old Testament, their purpose was to make known to all nations, what? The gospel, so that there can be an obedience to the faith. Now, what does that mean? Whenever we talk about being obedient to the faith, If you look at the word obedient and the word obey, and you connect it with the gospel, and it's in two other texts, and you'll find this. One's in 1 Thessalonians. It talks about the Lord returning in a flaming fire and vengeance upon them that obey not the gospel. What does it mean to obey the gospel? It simply means that we are to believe it, that we're to be saved. We're to obey that gospel call. We're to obey in the sense that we're to come to Christ for salvation. And so these scriptures, the purpose of the Word of God and the purpose of the Old Testament prophets, there was a primary purpose, I understand, when he was writing, but when the different prophets were writing. But there's also always secondary prophecy being fulfilled. Can I give you a couple examples? Well, I'll give you one for sure. Do you remember when David was praying and he talked about his friend that lifted up his hand against him? Remember that portion of Scripture? You know, Jesus or the New Testament uses that very verse to prove that David or that Jesus was going to be betrayed by Judas. Same verses. And so the primary interpretation of that verse was dealing with David and his friend Ahithophel who betrayed him. That's the primary interpretation. But there was also a secondary prophecy that was there speaking about the Messiah that was to come. And you can find that over and over and over again in the Old Testament, how there's a scripture given, and it has to do with what's going on right then, but it also had a prophetic fulfillment in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as these prophets were writing, they were giving us truth that was going to even frame the gospel when we get to the New Testament. And so Paul is writing to these believers, and he's writing them based off of the authority of God's Word. Now, Paul was a prophet, and we know that these 16 chapters are the very Word of God. But isn't it interesting that as God used Paul to write down his words, that Paul was careful to use for the basis of his words, Old Testament Scripture? Isn't that amazing? And if Paul, who's writing down the very Word of God, would use Scripture in his writings, how much more should preachers and teachers use the Word of God to prove their points when it comes to the teaching of the Word of God? And so here in verse 2, there's a promise. And that promise is that the Messiah was going to come, that gospel of God. And God fulfilled His promise. Now, look at verse number 3. Verse number 3, we're going to begin to deal with the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse number 3, the Bible says, go back to verse 1. But if you look, this is a very long sentence. That means it's all in context together. I don't know if you've ever noticed when you read a lot of Paul's writings, sometimes Paul goes 7 verses without a period like he does here. And that means it's all interconnected. And sometimes people will take one verse and don't even read the whole sentence so they can get the context. They'll just take that one verse and then they come up with some crazy doctrine. No, read the whole context. That way it's all strung together so you can see exactly what he's talking about. That's like if somebody quotes you and they only took a phrase out of your quote. They can misquote you very easy. Hey, sometimes the news channels are guilty of that. They interview someone, and that person tells them about an event, and next thing you know, they cut it up to make it say what they want it to say. And so it's important when we look at the Bible, we keep it in context. So all the way down through verse 7 is one sentence, and it's interconnected. Look what he says in verse 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Now the gospel of God in the Scriptures, from the Holy Scriptures, deals concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. You see how it's connected? The gospel of God, of course, is connected to his Son, God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, there are three titles that are given to Jesus in this text. Each of these three references reveal exactly who Jesus Christ is. Notice number 1, it says concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Notice the phrase his Son. Now, this statement leaves no wiggle room concerning the deity of Christ. What it's saying here is that Jesus is the very Son of God. Let me say this. He is the only begotten Son of God. It's unique. And so we find His deity as the Son. He is God. And so we find his deity is given there. And so that gives no wiggle room to his person concerning his son, Jesus. Notice he's also called Christ. Now, Christ simply means this, God's anointed or the Messiah. He's the one chosen of God to be the Savior of the world. And by the way, he is the only Savior of this world. Look in Acts chapter number 4. You know the verse, but I want you to look at it. It's so important for us to understand that there are not many ways to heaven. There are not many roads that'll take you to heaven. There are not many ways in order for you to get to God. We find here in Acts chapter 4 that the Lord is clear about this. So, it's, he said to be his son, God's son. He is called Christ. And we see as Christ, he is the only Savior. Acts 4 and verse 12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we, what's the next word? Must be saved. He's the only way. He's not a way, he's not a good way. He's the only way, and it's through him that you and I must be saved. Sometimes people get upset about that, and then they start using a bunch of hypotheticals, and they say, well, what about this child that's over in this country that has never heard the gospel? We're going to deal with that in a moment, but can I tell you what I believe? And I think I can prove it from Scripture, but I want to tell you what I believe. I believe if so-and-so in another country is really seeking after God and wanting to know the true God, I believe God's going to send somebody his way. I believe that. And that's why God raises up missionaries. You remember the Macedonian call? God, there was a man that was seeking after God. What did God do? God raised up Paul to go there and preach the gospel. So I believe that there needs to be an opportunity for all men. But I'll tell you this, God is just no matter what. Hey, we only can be saved through the Son. You and I can only be saved through the Son. And listen, if people don't hear the gospel message, that's not God's fault. It's our fault. And so we must be faithful with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he is the only way whereby men must be saved. He is the only way for men and women and boys and girls to have their sins forgiven. And so he said to be a son. He is called Christ. And that reveals him as the chosen of God, the only way to heaven. And then notice also in verse number 4, he is labeled as our Lord. The Bible says concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You know, people will say Jesus. But you know, folks don't like to hear that word Lord. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Listen, he's labeled as our Lord. This is the exaltation of Jesus Christ in his position. And while he is indeed Lord of all, he is especially to be Lord of all professing Christians. He ought to be our Lord. We ought to make him our Lord in our day-to-day life by following his example. And so we find the gospel. It's so important that the gospel be held up. It's so important that the gospel be taken to the lost. Why? Because Jesus is the only way for heaven. Now look at verse number 3 and notice the pedigree of Jesus. The Bible says concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh. Now within the Old Testament scriptures there's many promises made concerning Jesus Christ. But you'll find one that is repeated over and over again, and that is that Jesus is going to be, the son of David. He's going to be of the seed of David. When Jesus was walking on the earth, do you remember what people called him in the Gospel of Matthew? Thou son of David. Now that phrase you may read over and don't think about it, but that phrase literally means this. If the Davidic monarchy was in existence, those people were acknowledging that Jesus is the rightful heir to that Davidic throne. He was the one that was in line to sit upon the throne. And we may not understand it now, but back in those days, they kept meticulous records. Meticulous records. That we have the genealogies in the Bible, but also in the temple, they would keep meticulous records of whose father was whom, and they'd go down through the lineage. It was very important for the Jews. And so there was no question that Jesus would have been the one sitting upon the throne. Here's the interesting thing. Not only is he in line to sit on the throne because he is supposed to be the son of Joseph, which goes back to Solomon, but you'll find this, that also his mother Mary was in the line of David, and it goes back to David's other son by the name of Nathan. And so he was the one that would have been seated upon the throne. And so the promises that God gave of the Messiah coming and him being of the seed of David was absolutely fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. So look at verse number 4. It says, and declared to be the Son of God with power. So Jesus is being declared the Son of God. He is His Son, but there was a declaration that Jesus is the Son of God. So here's a powerful declaration that Jesus is the Son of God. Now before we read that, I want you to know that there are a couple other times in the Bible where Jesus is called the Son of God. He is declared publicly and powerfully that He is the Son of God. At Christ's baptism in Matthew 3:17, you remember? God spoke out of heaven and called Jesus his son. Not only that, in Matthew 17:5 on the Mount of Transfiguration, God called him again, my beloved son. But may I say this evening that the greatest declaration that we have concerning Jesus Christ being the Son of God is found in this verse. Look at verse 4. It says, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. The resurrection from the dead announced that He was who He said He was. And think about it this way. If Jesus was an imposter, would He have risen from the grave? He would not have. But because He did arise from the grave, we find that every statement that He made is true. And He is the Son of God. He declared that He was the Son of God. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ is proof positive that He is the Son of God and that declared Him as the Son of God with power. Now notice a powerful declaration, but also in this verse, we have a powerful demonstration. The Bible says this in verse number 4. It says, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. Notice, according to the Spirit of holiness. See, Jesus was the Holy One. You remember in the book of Acts? I believe it was Stephen that was preaching, and he called Him the Holy One. I believe it was also Peter that called Him the Holy One. And what we find is Jesus is that Holy One, and we find the demonstration coming forth through the Spirit of holiness that He was who He testified to be, and we find that He not only conquered death, but He conquered hell and the grave. And so, what an amazing, amazing thing. Verse number 5, I'm going to hurry here. Verse 5, it says, by whom? Now, who's the whom here? That takes you back to Jesus Christ. All right, verse 3, concerning His Son Jesus Christ our Lord, declared to be the Son of God. So it's dealing with Jesus Christ. It says, by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for His name. And so notice the reception of grace and apostleship. Now grace here, of course, it deals with salvation. And listen, that's how we're saved. We're saved by grace through faith. And so whenever we get saved, we have received grace. It's the grace of God, Ephesians 2:8 and 9. And so Jesus gives us grace and salvation. But here, Paul says, not only did I receive the salvation of my soul, but I also received the station of my service. And so Paul said, not only did I receive grace, but I also received apostleship. So God had a purpose for Paul's life. Now, I don't have time to go into it, but you can read in the book of Acts and you can find when God called him and what God told Ananias about the purpose of his life. If you go back and read that story, you'll find that God told Ananias, he talks about how much he's going to suffer for my name's sake. And so God had a specific ministry for him, but wrapped up in that ministry was going to be a life filled with suffering. And so he received grace. He also received apostleship. Now, what was the purpose of that apostleship? What was the purpose of it? Well, for the obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. And so the reason God raised up Paul is so that folks would hear the gospel and be saved. The Lord wanted to use him to take the gospel of Jesus Christ into the entire world that folks might be saved by faith from all nations. And that's what it's talking about. And so this is the gospel. Now let's look at verse 6 and we'll be done. The Bible says, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ? You know, we have been called by Christ unto salvation, all of us. Jesus said, if I be lifted up from the earth, talking about his crucifixion, I will draw all men unto me. And Christ is calling for men to be saved. We all have that call, and we all have received the grace of God, we who are saved. But we also have been given a purpose, and we're to find out what our purpose is, just like Paul found out what his was, and we're to fulfill that purpose. So that's the first six verses we've got to stop. So let's go ahead and stop right there. Next week we'll pick up there in verse number 7. And we're going to begin to look at the people of the church. We're going to start in verse 7. And we're going to look at the people there, those Roman Christians. And we're going to see what Paul says about them in verse number 7. But let me say this before we close in prayer. You're going to find that the book of Romans is about the gospel and it's about Jesus Christ. Probably there is no more clearer definition of the gospel than what we receive through the book of Romans. And so we've got the definition of the gospel, then we have the declaration of the gospel, then we have the demonstration of the gospel, how it changes lives. And so we're going to continue looking at this, and I hope it'll be a help and a blessing to you. Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Lord, thank you so much for this evening. Lord, thank you for these folks that are here. Lord, I just pray that as we, Lord, as we move forward this week and we try to serve you, that you would keep us safe tomorrow from the storms. But Lord, I pray you'd help us to lift up Christ. God, be with us tonight as we dismiss. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you can be dismissed.